Education is not the learning of facts, but the training of mind to think. Good morning, everyone. I, Jayant Singh Jadhav, student of BMHRD, take pleasure in opening up the penultimate session for the first day of this seminar by introducing Mr. Saurabh Nigam, Vice President, Human Capital at Omidia Network. Mr. Saurabh Nigam holds a postgraduate diploma in personal management and industrial relations from XLRI School of Businesses and Human Resources, Jamshedpur, India. He also holds SPHR, GPHR and HRMP certifications from SHRM, USA, being the only Indian and one among the first 10 people globally to hold these three certifications simultaneously. Sir has been recognized as one of the top 25 future HR leaders of the country by People Matters and DDI International. He is a recipient of HR Leadership Award from the Asia Pacific HRM Congress 2010, Young HR Professional of the Year at Asia's Best Employer Brand Awards 2012, and the Young HR Manager of the Year Award at IHRD National HR Conference 2012. Mr. Saurabh started his career as a faculty of mathematics at IMS Learning Resources and served many organizations with his skills and expertise like Capgemini, Software Consultant, Aditya Birla Group, AGM HR, Bureau, Incorporation, Vice President, Head HR, and Snapdeal, Senior Vice President, Head HR. Now, I request Mr. Saurabh Nigam to take charge of the dais.
Once again, good morning, everyone. Thanks a lot for a really warm welcome. This is not the first time here on your campus, though I'm here after almost 5 years. I've been here multiple times before that. I'm sure none of you would have seen me because I'm assuming all of you have been here for either 1 or 2 years, right? Last time I was on campus was about 5 years back in 2012, as I said. And I've done this before. Standing here on this dais, facing 1,000-odd students sitting here with the kind of energy you folks have, you always make me nervous, right? Because to match that kind of energy is always difficult. Right? But I'll try my level best. It's just that I'm a little handicapped today because I'm down with fever and cold as well. But let's see how it goes. Right? So, while I have an agenda here, I've put a presentation over here as well. I do understand that we've been sitting here since morning and listening to some really great personalities and great corporate leaders. I'm going through the list of folks who have come in and spoken to you and people who will come in and speak as well, right? I really want to take a pause here and want to check if there's something like this group wants to listen to, hear from me, want me to talk about. If there's something in your mind, feel free to if I can address that. Otherwise, I already have a agenda with you, which I will definitely go through with you. Right? So, is there anything which comes to your mind when you are coming in the morning that at least somebody should touch upon this topic and it may be worth it? Anyone? I know it's difficult, right? It's difficult listening to people, person after person. But anything in your mind? By the way, if you did think about what you're going to do in this on this one day, or I think it's a 2 day or 3 day seminar. Sorry, you did?
3 days.
3 days, okay. 3 day seminar. If you haven't put an agenda for yourself that, okay, I'm going to take away something out of these 3 days, then you're missing the point, right? Because 24 into 3 or say 10 into 3, 30 hours of your time you're spending here in this room. By the end of those 30 hours, if you don't want to take anything out of it, then those 30 hours have gone waste. Yeah? The point I'm trying to make here is, whenever you are investing your time, ensure that you're getting maximum out of it. It's your time again. Right? Right? So that's my question. Anything in your mind you want to talk about, you want to hear, you want to listen to, you have any doubts, queries, questions which you want to talk about, or you want me to go through the agenda and then we can figure out. Okay. No. What? On what parameters?
So human capital.
Human capital.
And okay. There are the countries like Norway and Finland, they are lacking that. So they are
yeah.
So while we are lacking in innovation, while we have lots of knowledge in as the diversity in the population is much. And sir, when the India will lead in the innovation because we lack in research and development. And yes, sir, I have seen in manufacturing field, the engineers do the work of IT people or IT people do the work of engineers.
Yeah. Thankfully, you asked me a question which is answered in my presentation, so I'll come to that. I was really worried when you brought the World Economic Forum. I was thinking, well, what if I've not read the report? But I will definitely address that. Please be seated.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah.
So my name is Varsha Gupta. So actually, you invest in telecom sector. So I just wanted to know,
I
mean, telecom sector, you
want
those sectors, right?
Okay, we don't invest in telecom, we invest in technology. But yeah, you can still ask that. And so what I'm going to talk about are two parts of my presentation, or two parts to my session. So increasingly what has happened, right, as more and more bright minds like you come into the corporate world, join the corporate world, there's a huge challenge which we are facing as corporates, right? Not because a lot of people are coming in, that's great, right? The challenge is that the younger generation which is coming, I hate to use younger generation because that means that I'm on the other side, but still, folks like you who are coming into the corporates, there's a distinct mindset, aspirations and expectations which you folks bring to the table, right, when you come into the corporate world, right? Now, you can call yourself the Gen Ys or the millennials, whatever word you want to use it. So, what I'm going to talk about is that how are we as corporates looking to prepare ourselves to be able to manage the aspirations and expectations of youngsters who are coming into our organization, right? Now, it's important for us to do that because as you come in, right, with your aspirations and expectations into our organization, unless we are able to have systems and processes and policies in place which align with your aspirations and expectations, we're going to find it very difficult to hold you back or retain you with us, right? And that's going to be a losing proposition for us, right? And that's mainly the reason why I spent a lot of time in the last about 8 or 9 years by working with different young startup-ish organizations in different industries, trying to figure out what exactly are the aspirations and expectations of people like you, and that's what I'm going to present. And then using that, come up with some sort of talent management strategies, some sort of human capital practices, which would help organizations not just attract but also motivate and retain Gen Y or millennials or whatever you may call them. And that's why the topic of my presentation, the first part of my presentation is managing Gen Y, right? People like you. However, the other side is equally important. I also believe that it's never a one-way traffic, right? It can never be that the organization will do everything to prepare themselves to be able to match up to your expectations and aspirations. But you won't do anything. Right? So there is an equal responsibility on your side as well. So by the end of my presentation, I'll also talk about what do we expect. And when I say we as corporate, what do we corporates expect from the youngsters who are coming into our organizations? And we'll quickly touch upon that. More than happy to take any questions, post that during the presentation as well. As I said, it's important for you to understand because I'm coming in with the perspective of having seen this in different organizations. When a lot of youngsters come in, right, and many times organizations are not prepared to match up to their expectations and aspirations, right? So I've put all of my research in this, and basis that, as I said, the other half, which is what do we corporates expect, right? So it will be important as you move into the corporate world to have those tenets in your mind that how do you prepare yourself before you move into the corporate world, move back or move into the corporate world, okay? All of you with me? Interesting enough?
Yes,
sir. In case you find it boring, just let me know. We'll do another exercise. Okay? Alright, so quickly getting into the agenda. So this is what I've talked about, right? We'll define Gen Y as a quick one. Why Gen Ys are important and what is their significance? When I'm saying Gen Y, actually, I do believe that each one of you belong to that category, right? So we'll talk about that. What do we know about Gen Y? When I say we, corporates, right? So what is my learning, having managed Gen Ys and millennials for a period of almost 9-10 years now? So we'll talk a little about that. And therefore, basis that, how do we attract, motivate, and retain the millennials or the Gen Ys or the youngsters who are coming to our board, right? And then last section of my presentation is more about what do we expect as corporates from you, as I said. So what can you do, right? And some ideas around it. So let's start with the first one. A quick generation timeline. Now this, if you see, veterans, baby boomers, Gen X and Gen Y, this is a term, these are terms which will coin in US, but you know, can be applicable pretty much across board. And there are multiple definitions for different researchers, but typically the most often we use definition to define Gen Yers or millennials are people who are born after 1981. Anybody who's born before 1981, I'm leaving aside the first row of this case. Yeah? Any of the students who, anybody sitting here, born before 1981? Hey, don't pull a fast one on someone, right? Okay, no one, right? So all of you belong to this category. So these are the people typically who are now moving into the workforce, right? And that's what I said. Now, the reason why this is important, it is important for us to understand, and before we get into that, a quick look at how or is Gen Y really different? Are people, the youngsters who are coming into the workforce now, people who were born after 1980s or 1981, are they really different? So what I've done is I've plotted different generations of employees, which you typically see in an organization, the veterans, the baby boomers, the Gen X and the Gen Ys, and have tried to plot what do they feel about different aspects of human capital practices or organization initiatives, right? So what do they think about work ethic and values? What work means to them? How do they communicate, right? What do they think about feedback and rewards? And what are the kind of messages that motivate them, right? So now if you really see, and we can pick up any one of these, right? Look at work, right? So if you really see what work meant to possibly your grandfather, right? And how they viewed their work, irrespective of which field they were in, or how your dad or your mom for that matter viewed work, right? And how you view work as, is very different, right? So while work would be an obligation for somebody who comes from a veteran side, or somebody who's a veteran, somebody who was born in the 1920s and 45, 1920 to 45, right? It was almost an obligation that you had to do, a duty which you had to do, in order to sustain yourself and sustain your family, right? And that's what the mindset was about work. If you really move up, right, and look at, somebody from Gen X, somebody from a generation like me or a little before me, right? For them, it was a difficult challenge, a contract between an employer and an employee, right? And you had to go through that contract as per the terms and conditions, and that's how it was. There was no personal attachment or association over there. It was a contract, and that contract had to be fulfilled. Whereas, if you really look at the young Gen Ys who are now coming to the organization, it's just a means to an end. Job or work is just a means to an end. And now that end, what that end is differs from person to person, right? So if you, and that's the reason why you really look at the turnover rates and the average tenure of a person in an organization ranges from 2 to 3 years today, right? Why? Because they are just looking at that particular work, that particular role as a means to an end, right? The moment that stops having its relevance, they move to the next one, right? That was not the case. I mean, my father worked in Indian Army for 38 years, right? And he freaks out every time I tell him, oh, I'm going to change my job, right? Because for him, that notion doesn't even exist, right? He comes from a generation which believes that work is a contract, right? So if there's a contract, you have to serve that contract, right? How can you leave that job? But that's the notion which is changing. That's changing for the youngsters who are coming into the workforce now. And there's no right or wrong here, by the way. I'm not here to say, okay, this is right or that's wrong. But that's what it is. If you look at rewards, feedback and rewards, right? A typical Gen Yer would want a reward which is instantaneous, there and there. You do something good, get it now, give it to me now, right? Compare that to somebody who came from previous generations, they would be more attuned to a reward or a feed or a feedback which was told to do was in person. A feedback given in person rather than in public is or was more preferred way for older generations. Whereas for this generation, give it to me out there in open, be direct about it. That's how I would like to work. Right? So there's a difference. Now to this slide essentially, and I'm not going to go for the point, but the slide essentially is this to ascertain the point that there is a different difference between how different human capital practices or things get viewed by different generations. Right? And that's what I'm trying to indicate. Right? Now because it's different, right, a cookie cutter approach or one single approach to creating human capital practices in an organization when you have people from different generations working together will not work. Right? So why Gen Y over here? Now the question is that if there are four different kind of different generations working together in an organization, why am I choosing to work or choosing to talk about Gen Y? One reason because like all of you belong to that generation, belong to that group, but also because of this reason. Right? Now if you really look at the demographics and most of this research is not just India based, it covers the entire globe. More than 50% of the current global workforce comes from or is made up of Gen Yers or millennials. Right? So the majority of the workforce which is now in working in different organizations, different setups, is made up of Gen Yers. Right? So that's number one reason. And now if you really calibrate and come down, and this is based on research in US, majority of your middle managers and high are right as people are rising up are from your Gen Y population. So you know slowly, not just the entry-level jobs, but also middle management in organizations are being taken up by Gen Y. Because the population or the middle or the number of people who are coming into the workforce from this generation is so huge. Right? And by 2025, it's predicted that right now the number which is about 50% would be close to about 75-80% of the workforce would be made up of Gen Y. So clearly what we're talking about is if the businesses, organizations have to ensure that they're able to attract the best talent from this data generation coming into the workforce, they have to fundamentally relook at how they operate, how they manage their human capital practices, HR practices, right? Why? Because as you saw in the previous slide, this generation does think differently, right? They have different aspirations, they have different ways of looking at feedback, rewards, work, performance, right? Now, what worked possibly 20 years back would not, or most probably will not work for the generation which is coming in, right? Key remark over here by a scholar who did this research, while majority of the workforce constitutes, or more than 50% of the workforce today constitutes of Gen Yers or millennials, only 7% of these Gen Yers, and this is a US number, only 7% of Gen Yers are choosing to work with a Fortune 500 company, right? So only 7% of the population from your generation is choosing to work with a big organization which are in the league of Fortune 500. What is happening to the rest? They are either choosing to go the startup way, younger organization, new ideas, or choosing to do something on their own, entrepreneurs, right? Now, clearly, this is a big question mark for all these big organizations which are looking to sustain themselves and continue on the path they've been for years and years together, that if people who are constituting majority of the workforce are not choosing to work with them, there's a huge question mark there, what can they do in order to pull them, attract them, and make them work with them. Right? And that's really the reason why this generation is important. All of you with me? Yeah? Okay. So what do we know about them? Right? And this is interesting because there can be thousands of different views and perceptions about it, but this is my take, and let's see what we talk about. Right? Now, before I present my views, I'm going to ask a quick question to the entire audience sitting here, barring the first row for sure. How many of you have heard one or more of these terms being used to describe you by your elders? Yeah, that you're spoiled, you're lazy, you have very poor work ethic, you have unrealistic expectations, you don't have social skills, you don't know how to talk to people. Yeah? At least one of these words to describe you? Yes, sir. Yes, no?
Yes, sir.
can't hear. Simple, yes. Sounds talking? It shouldn't sound talking, right? Very normal, right? Yeah, all of you good? Your elders talking about your elder brother, sister, parents, grandparents, uncles, aunts, saying one or more of these things to you, right?
Yes.
Yeah? Is it fair? Is it true? It's true. Wow. Wow. Self-reflective. Yeah, what does the audience think about it? Are you guys like this? You are lazy? You have poor work ethic? You don't know your social skills? You all agree with that? Let me ask another question, right? If you do not agree with this, then what exactly are you? And we'll talk about that, right? Now, if you really ask me personally, I don't believe any of this is true, right? And the reason I say that is because of a couple of reasons, right? One, I do believe that this generation is, and without any doubt, is the most technologically advanced generation than any other previous generation, right? Now, there's some merit to that, there's some reason credit to you for that, but there's also the fact that you were born and brought up in the time when technology has just boomed. Right? So now we are in a stage where you are faced with a question. It doesn't even take more than 2 minutes to figure out thousands and thousands of answers related to that question. Right? So for you, it's the world has changed. Right? From a time 20 years back when we were faced with a question, we had to go to a library, pick up volumes and volumes of books and figure out the answer. And many times it used to take not just days, weeks and months to figure out an answer. Right? It's changed for you. Right? What that has also mean is that this is a generation which is possibly far more well aware about what's happening around the world, what's happening in your respective field than possibly any other generation. Right? Of which that therefore has meant that the way you look at work, the way you operate, the way you try to approach a problem and look for a solution is fundamentally different than what the other generation, previous generations have done. And therefore, there is almost a myth that this generation is lazy or has poor work ethic, right? Or believes in too much of flexibility, right? That's because the environment and the context in which you have come up is very different. And therefore, I almost believe that these are myths, right? These are not true. So what's true actually, and what are some of the characteristics of Gen Y? Now these are the four really strong ones which we have seen, which I have seen in the last 10 odd years. You know, extremely self-directed, seeking advancement opportunities, asking questions that what does it take for me to move forward in life, move forward in career, looking at learning opportunities, highly result-oriented, extremely impatient about results, right? Wants results to come in fast because you have access to information. Readily available, and highly tech-savvy multitasker, again, backed by technology, right? So if these are the four fundamental aspects of what a Gen Yer looks like, what do they want? Right? And this is, again, from the experience of managing folks, from their bosses, from their companies, and their willingness or eagerness to learn. Right? Now, if you really look at it, it all boils down to what I talked about on the previous slide. Right? So, what do they want from their bosses? They want their bosses to help them navigate career paths, help them understand what would it take for me to go from point A to point B, and they need complete clarity around it. Right? There cannot be any ambiguity around it because that does not make sense to them. Right? So, willing to put in the hard work, willing to go the extra mile, go the extra distance in order to succeed, in order to move up the ladder, but that clarity has to be provided. That's the expectation, number one expectation, right? Lot of fake feedback, as we talked about and looked at my first slide, they believe in fake feedback. So good or bad, give me fake feedback. And many, many times, that's where the manager relationship breaks down because the previous generations are not very comfortable giving fake feedback, right? What else? They also believe in getting mentored and coached by people above them who are at higher levels than them. From companies that look at training programs, companies with really strong values, reward packages which are customized as per their needs, that's what they look at from organizations. And then the other aspect is, I personally believe, they have that never-ending zeal to learn, right? Because there's so much information available, right, that learning, the zeal to learn and learn new things, it never ends with this generation. Now, if some of you, by the way, disagree and feel that out of place and out of, I don't think like this, then you ask yourself that, you know, why you don't think like this. But that's the scenario I'm talking about with when we look at people from your generation who come and work with us in organizations. And therefore, how do we attract, motivate, and retain people? Now that we know a little bit more about the Gen Yers and the millennials, what can we do as organizations to attract, motivate, and retain Gen Yers? And some of our thoughts are here, right? Having a corporate culture which nurtures talent, right? So when I say nurture, giving opportunities to learn, giving opportunities to advance, giving opportunities to grow, right? That's something which is extremely important for the Gen Yers to thrive. Job flexibility, extremely critical, right? So this is not a generation which can be tied down by a 9-to-5 routine in the corporate world. It just does not happen, right? So providing flexibility in your work routines, in your job schedule is extremely important for this generation to go. Challenging work, very important, because this generation cannot sustain monotony, right? So how do you make the work which you're giving out to this generation challenging day in and day out is a responsibility which the organization has. Advancement opportunities, I already talked about. Recognition programs, giving recognition which are instantaneous, which are customizable. Gone are the days when a Gen Y would be happy to receive a certificate. Okay? Gone are the days when a Gen Y would be happy to receive a 10,000 cash award. He or she would be far happy to get concert tickets, movie tickets, or dinner for two, right? Those are, I'm just giving examples, but those are the customization which you need to do in your reward program in order for them to attract and then, you know, appeal to the generation. And so, how do you motivate and retain? So, I'm going to skip this slide straight away and go here. Offering perks, having fun at work, providing flexibility at work is no longer an innovation. Okay? I think we have reached the stage wherein organizations have to almost build this as an inherent part of their culture in order to sustain retain and keep their young population motivated. It's no longer innovation. 10 years back, it used to be innovative to have a food court in office. It used to be innovative to have a basketball court or a gym in office. It no longer is. It's almost like a given, right? Defining career paths, making sure that they're explicitly made available to every single individual is the other aspect which is extremely important. Freedom to innovate, try out new things, try out different things, because this generation is always full of ideas, right? So that's the other aspect which is very important, which you provide. Provide them ample training opportunities to learn new things, to develop themselves, to grow, is the other aspect. Keeping them engaged, is extremely important, because the mind can divert. I mean, the mind which I've seen with the youngsters who come in, can they go in multiple directions, right? So how do you keep them engaged and focused on the work and make sure that, you know, that they're delivering is extremely important. Now, there are different ways of engaging, but figuring that out is extremely important. And having a clear roadmap to success and defining it for them, right? What success is in this organization when you come in, and how do you achieve that success? That entire roadmap is extremely important, because they do ask that question. And they will ask that question, and that's what I've experienced. And so some of the things which we can do as organizations to attract, motivate, and retain their buyers. Make sense, by the way? Are you guys with me?
Yes, sir.
So coming down to the second last part of my presentation, or the second half of the presentation, that they're not talking about what corporates can do, what do we understand about Gen Yers, people from the organization, and what can we do to attract, motivate, and retain. There's a slide on what we expect as well. And it's important for you to reflect upon yourself, that are you preparing yourself around these, I'm going to talk about only four things, which are expectations which corporates will have from you as you move in. Okay? First one, define your essence. And I'm going to spend like a minute or two over here. It should be very clear to you that what do you stand for as an individual, as a professional, right? And I understand that it evolves over a period of time, but now your management graduates or management students, and you're going to move out of the institute in a couple of years' time frame. By the time you move out, it should be amply clear to you that what do you stand for as a professional, what do you really want to do, what are the kind of opportunities you want, and what is the stream you want to go in, right? there's a huge amount of diverse opportunities which exist out there in the world. It should be very clear to you that what would you want to do with yourself. Because unless it's clear to you, nobody else will be able to help you. Right? And the last thing you would want is go into an organization and then figure out that what you're expected to do, or the work which has been given out to you, or the career path on which you'll be put in, is not something which appeals to you. Right? Now, see, an organization will have their own career paths in the workplace as they define it. It's up to you to figure out whether that appeals to you or not. And in order for that to happen, you need to find your essence. You need to find out what you stand for and what appeals to you as a professional. What do you want to pursue? Okay? Once you have that clarity in mind, you will figure out which path you want to go, or which organization you want to go for that time. Right? Second one, extremely important, be absolutely open to feedback. I mean, have seen more than once the tendency that a feedback, especially if it is not a favorable feedback, almost gets taken ultimately turns into grievance, but it almost gets taken as a personal insult. It's not. Please understand that when a manager or a superior in your organization or in your team is giving you a feedback, they have all the right intent and the good intent to give you that feedback because they want you to become a better professional, especially when you're just entering into the organization. Right? Now that feedback is meaningless if it's not taken in the right manner. Right? So please do take feedback and be open about it. Right? Ultimately, what you do with that feedback is your choice. Right? But if there's a genuine, constructive feedback being given out to you, you should be able to take that and imbibe and implement the corrective measures on yourself. This is very important, and I personally believe a lot on it. There is absolutely no substitute for hard work. Okay? Let's be very clear about it. The Rome was not built in one day. No career was built in one day. Right? How many of you want to have great careers, want to grow, want to get promoted, want to reach the highest levels of the corporate hierarchy? Anybody who doesn't want to do this? No, right? Now that doesn't happen unless you put in the hard work. Right? And tremendous amount of hard work. Right? Never ever be shy of putting in 110, 150, 200% of effort into what you're doing. It never would go waste, number one. Number two, that's what will differentiate you from others. Right? Somebody talked about innovation here, right? So I think the last point is where it comes down to. Right? It's just great to have an MBA degree. Right? All of you will have an MBA degree very soon. Right? But do not ever, ever believe that this is it, you have arrived at night, or the learning is over. And because that's the day when you will start falling out. In fact, an MBA degree, or a master's degree for that matter, should be just treated as a beginning of a huge, huge learning road ahead of you. Right? Never stop learning in whichever field you are, in whatever essence you have defined for yourself. Because the world is changing very fast, and you know better than me. Right? Whether it's in technology, whether it's in finance, whether it's in marketing, HR, the world is changing very, very fast. Now, for you to be relevant, you have to continuously learn new things. And the onus of learning has to come from your side. Right? While organizations, corporates will provide training curriculums and learning paths and so forth, but unless you are ready to learn, unless you have the attitude to grasp and willingness to learn new things to be able to continue to be relevant in the corporate world, right? You will very soon lose out. Right? And that's where I think innovation comes in. I mean, unless you are continuously looking ahead of what the world is already doing, right? And then learning, and then using that learnings to create new things, innovation will not happen. And that's where we lose out. Right? Because we have a tendency to be happy with what we have and be comfortable with it. Right? So somebody gave an example of why the Western world, there's far more research and development and innovation, right? Because we're not focusing on that learning aspect, right? So only four things. I mean, they can be like I could have come with a list of 10 things, but as you prepare yourself to get into the corporate world, make sure that you're willing to work hard, really hard. I mean, there is absolutely no substitute for that. Continue to learn, continue to learn as much as you can, because that's important for you to be relevant. Be open to feedback, constructive feedback, imbibe it, and you know, make sure that you take corrective actions around it. And most importantly, define what your essence is, what you stand for, what you want your career to be. And if you're able to do that, trust me, you will be on the right path. You will reach where you want to ultimately. Okay? So with that, I've come to the last slide, which is the conclusion. And the conclusion is, the Gen Ys, as they constitute more than half the working population. They are different, they think different, they have different aspirations. It's really a time for us to reflect as corporates that how do we make our shift on our human capital practices in order to attract, motivate, and retain this talent and this workforce and this generation. But also there's an equal onus on you to be able to make yourself relevant for the corporate world, for the organization, for the higher wage. So figure it out how you're going to do that. But with that, I'm going to leave you with that thought. So that's the end of my presentation. More than happy to have any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. The house is now open for questions and answers.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Rishika Agrawal from HR. Today, when talking about Gen Y, then the trend of remote work, or I can say work from home, is catching the pace. So the companies are opting for it for cutting the cost of infrastructure and also for the new mothers, respecting mothers, etc. For just to not to put a halt to their career, etc. So along with it comes the risk of confidentiality as they're working at home. So fraudulent practices can happen. You cannot judge that are they working properly or give proper time. So what's your opinion about it? That should companies opt for it or should it stop?
Good question. There are two aspects to it. One, whether company should opt for it or not, if you ask me, my personal take, definitely yes. That's my personal take. But I also understand that not every organization or every business can possibly afford to have the people working on teams. Right? So, for example, a BPO, right, or a call center, or a manufacturing setup, right, cannot afford to have their people sitting out of it. I mean, the cars will not be made, right, or the calls will not be answered. Right? So, it differs from organization to organization. But having said that, just to answer your question on confidentiality and how do you make sure that people are working, there are two different aspects. Confidentiality can easily be maintained by having the proper IT infrastructure, and there's enough of it. Right? So if there are IT folks sitting in the room, you can check with them. There's VPN, there's a secure network and all that. So you can ensure that more data goes out of your network or out of your system, no matter where the person is working from. So that's easy. I mean, the technology has evolved to that extent. As far as how do you ensure that people are working? I think that depends on the culture of the organization, right? And that it all depends on how you treat people, right? Amount of trust you have on them, and the entire performance review mechanism and how you give feedback, and the entire loop will ensure that you know there is an output coming out of every single person, irrespective of where they are working. So it actually depends on the culture of the organization to ensure that you know there is productivity from people. Let us pick up whether they work.
So at the end of the day, you are not sure
that
are
the people or employees giving proper time to their
work and only a monthly feedback
as in when you check the report. Daily basis is it possible to check whether that... It all depends on from work to work, work profile to work. You can't. If there is a defined set of things which you're supposed to do on a particular day, right? Why can't check? Why not? Why can't I?
The login system would help from this, like the person logging at which time, log out at which time.
That's one way.
Just one way.
That's just one way. See, ultimately, what you should be bothered about is whether the output is coming. Right? Nowadays, it's the gone are the days when they punch in and punch out. I mean, it still works in setups like call centers, manufacturing setups, and so forth. But in knowledge space, especially in the technology space where I've worked a lot, wherein, so for example, if I want to take the example of Appy, wherein the bulk of the organization was made up of techies who were creating this massive technology platform on which we were running e-commerce, right? Now their task was to create that technology platform, write code and make that technology platform succeed, right? Now writing of that code can happen from anywhere. They need not come to work, right? But we were very clear that suppose you, right, as a person, you are working on a certain code and that code has to be delivered by the next 5 days. What I will measure you against is whether you have delivered that code in that with that quality next 5 days or not. From where you do it, it doesn't matter. They might be different differ from context to context, from organization to organization.
Okay. And just one last point that the reimbursement part or the compensation part.
Compensation
part should be equal to the person who are coming to office and like.
It's very subjective. Like, not be, it depends. It really depends on what work the person is doing, how many hours they're putting in, what output they're giving or giving, whether it's full time, part time. It all depends. There's multiple factors.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. It was enlightening to know the importance of gender and the understanding of it. It's equally important to have the perception and fundamentals of Gen Y clear. The millennials, so-called as, should define their essence, be open to feedback, should know there is no substitute for hard work, and never stop learning. We should be relevant. Thank you once again.